Welcome to Best Picture This, where it is always Oscar season. I'm Mike.
And I'm Brian. In this show, we reevaluate every Best Picture nominee from the 21st century and decide whether to keep it or kick it from its Oscar pedestal.
Before we get started, though, Brian, a question. Are you now or have you ever been a fan of Seabiscuit, Ray, or Chocolat?
There are moments of all of them that I liked.
The people deserve to know. Be straight with us here. Are we going to have to get a second hearing committee about this? But this is a big day, Brian, because we're kicking off the series on the films of 2005. 2004 is done. It's in the past. But the nominees.
The 2005 is in the present.
The 2005 is kind of, in a way, it's in the present. It's in our present right now. But back in 2005, the nominees for Best Picture were Brokeback Mountain, Capote, Munich, Crash, and today's movie, Good Night and Good Luck, directed by George Clooney. Here's the trailer.
Let me see this.
It's a loyalty oath to America.
Are you now, or have you ever been?
I thought it was a joke at first. Murrow signed it.
Murrow signed it? If you don't sign this, are you and I a target?
If I don't sign it, they'll fire me.
10 seconds. Ready on camera, then.
Good evening.
Any man who protects communists is not fit to wear that uniform.
You can't convict people by rumor and hearsay and innuendo.
Are my children going to be asked to denounce me? Are they going to be judged on what their father was labeled? I see a chain reaction that has no end.
Charges were in a sealed envelope. Nobody saw them.
Wouldn't you guess that the people who have seen the contents of that envelope might have a better idea of what makes someone a danger to his country? Or do you think it should just be you that decides?
Who are the people? Are they elected? Are they appointed? Is it you?
I've searched my conscience, and I can't find any justification for this.
Our next show is going to be about Senator McCarthy. We're going to go right at him.
We will not walk in fear one of another. This is no time for men who oppose Senator McCarthy's methods to keep silent.
Mr. Edward R. Murrow has made repeated attacks upon me and those fighting communists.
Somebody's going to go down.
You're going to get audited this year.
Not me, you.
McCarthy wants April 6th.
I will not be deterred.
He's going to come after me.
You understand the position you're putting us in?
Let's walk very carefully through these next few moments.
Why don't you just fire me now? Go after Joe Kennedy. We'll pay for it.
Murrow is the symbol, the leader, and the cleverest of the jackal pack. Engaged in propaganda for communist causes.
Okay, fellas, here we go. We might as well go down swinging.
We're gonna go with the story, because the terror is right here in this room.
10 seconds.
5, 4, 3.
We cannot defend freedom abroad by deserting it at home. Good night and good luck.
It's a good trailer.
Is this the best action movie since The Insider?
By that trailer, you'd think so. But The Insider, oh, let's not compare these two yet, because my comments might not be very kind.
Well, I hope that you liked this movie, Mike.
I did.
As a
spoiler,
I'm going to give you a hard time about it.
I do feel like I don't want to give too much away from later in the episode, but I do feel like if you say you don't like this movie,
are you
a communist?
You are. Okay, so this movie was nominated for 6 Academy Awards. Best Picture, as we already know. Best actor in a leading role, David Strathairn. What do you think about that?
Yeah,
it's not really a role that lends itself to best acting nominations, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I think he's good. He's very good, but it's just not like it's one note, you know.
Yeah, he's a very good presence, and he does. I looked at some videos of the real Murrow, and there is a striking similarity, but
it's an impersonation.
Yeah, exactly.
Just like we've talked about so many times.
His face hardly changes.
I know. It's so true.
It's a little bit odd for best actor.
He's very good at looking stiff and uncomfortable.
That's this movie, right? That's what the movie's called.
George Clooney was nominated for Best Director. Best Writing Original Screenplay, George Clooney and Grant Heslov. And cinematography, Robert Elswit, who is tremendous, fantastic. He's done a lot of Paul Thomas Anderson's movies, including Punch Drunk Love, which we both enjoy.
That's good.
He also won an Oscar in 07 or for the 07 movie, There Will Be Blood.
Do we remember if Punch Drunk Love was nominated for Best Cinematography?
It wasn't. Right? It should have been. Oh, come on. It was amazing.
But this one's in black and white, Brian.
It's more important.
Exactly. Exactly.
He's also done some other George Clooney movies. Also, not on the award circuit for the movies exactly, but Diane Reeves, who does all the jazz singing in the movie.
Yeah, she's great.
She's really great. Her album, which was created with these songs, won the Grammy in 2006 for Best Jazz Vocal Album. Mm. An interesting little tidbit about how this was made. Every 23 minutes in the movie, precisely, which is the standard running time of TV shows in the 50s, and pretty much still is. Like, I mean, Seinfeld was around that long.
Yeah.
A new song comes on every 23 minutes. Kind of showing like, I don't know, it was like commercial break or something.
Yeah.
It was made for $7 million. And the box office was 54.6. George Clooney had a hard time making this movie because he had just hurt his back in Syriana.
Okay.
And so he couldn't get...
He couldn't do stunts in this one?
He couldn't bend down quite as dramatically as he wanted to and sit on the ground while he's... but he couldn't get insured.
Oh.
So he had to, first of all, he only took $1 for writing. He took $1 for directing and $1 for acting.
That's cool.
He got $3 for making the movie himself. And he also mortgaged his house in LA to help finance the movie. It eventually made $54 million. So, I mean, he got his money back, but...
I always wonder about the mortgaging your house thing, because Clooney was at a place in his career where he should have been doing
poor.
Okay.
I don't think he was poor at the time.
Maybe he was cash poor. He just needed to mortgage to get a little bit of that. A little fluid.
I bet that house was pretty decent mortgage on it.
I would think so, yeah.
So coming up in the show, we will do our Farley Awards for the most awesome moment of the movie. We'll do our golden takes. I will then ask Mike one question that will finally make him feel comfortable wearing his wedding ring again. We will imagine what might have been, talk trivia, and the big reveal, will you keep it or kick it from the top five?
But first, our most awesome moment of the movie, The Farleys. And for me, this was tough because this is a movie that purposefully avoids any kind of flash. You know, I already said the guy who plays Murrow, Stratham, is that what you said?
Strathairn.
Strathairn.
That's how you pronounce it, yeah.
His face hardly almost, it never changes the whole movie. So instead, I kind of tried to go a different way with this. And I'm going to go with a chunk from one of Murrow's speeches that I found sort of the most relevant to today. This speech is sort of a retort to McCarthy, who criticized him in a recent TV appearance. And just like the rest of Murrow's dialogue, it's written very, very simply, just the facts. He says, "The senator charged that Professor Harold Lasky, a British scholar and politician, dedicated a book to me. That's true. He is dead. He was a socialist. I am not. He was a civilized individual who did not insist upon agreement with his political principles as a precondition for conversation or friendship." He goes on, "I believed years ago, and I believe today, that mature Americans can engage in conversation and controversy, the clash of ideas with communists anywhere in the world, without becoming contaminated or converted. I believe that our faith, our conviction, our determination are stronger than theirs, and that we can successfully compete not only in the area of bombs, but in the area of ideas." That's great. And
that's good stuff.
Obviously relevant in the 50s, but I would argue that it's more relevant today than it was in 2005 when this movie came out.
Could be. It's not just about communism now. It's about like everything that you might disagree with anybody. It's like you're...
As social media
is pretty sad.
Rises, you know, we can become even more insulated by picking only the voices that we want to hear. And then there's no space left in our heads or our life for anybody who disagrees with us. So I thought that was pretty interesting.
Murrow, the events of this movie were, let me see, I made note of this in 1954. So you think about how young TV is at this time. It's kind of like almost like social media new or even more so. I mean, TV, I don't know exactly when TV was invented, but I always think of the 50s as kind of like...
When it was popularized in people's living rooms.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
So it's kind of interesting that not only...
new technology, new tool.
Yeah. Not only are they kind of fighting for civil liberties and the soul of America on a grander scale, but for the soul of TV. Like, how is this going to be used?
Exactly.
It's interesting.
It is. My Farley Award is for the cinematography. Robert Elswit. I took some screenshots and I will share them on Facebook. But I love how David Strathairn's character, Ed Murrow, is, you see TVs in the background of a lot of shots, a lot of shots. It's kind of like in your face in a way. But there's other shots that it's kind of like, it's kind of subtle. Like you walk into a room and there's a little TV that's facing you on the camera, and it's everywhere. And I think that's kind of, it's the theme of the show, what the power of and the ubiquity of TV. That's just new. Mm-hmm. But when Strathairn's, when Ed Murrow is like looking at, he's watching something and you see like his face is just as large on the screen behind him because of the way that Ed, Robert Elswit is shooting this.
Yeah.
It's just as large as his actual face is, and his face is filling, you know, top to bottom of the frame pretty much. And I just thought that the way they did all that interplay was just so fascinating and made me, again, as I'm watching the movie, I'm like, I'm kind of excited to see what the next shot will be. And it seems like one of those movies that you could take apart shot by shot and kind of like appreciate something about it, you know, each time. This is again why I just one of the things that attracts me so much to watching movies in general is, I mean, imagine, you know, going to a museum and you see like photos on a museum wall. You have that to the nth degree in a movie, and the best cinematographers are putting just as much care into each shot as these artists are in the works that end up in a museum.
Yeah.
And it's just incredible that you see it sometimes for half a second or a second, and then it goes on, and that might've taken hours to set up. It might've been, you know, it's just amazing. So I would think that in this movie, Robert Elswit's work, and it's hard to say where, how much his work, it's a big collaboration obviously between the director and the cinematographer, but his contribution to the movie is just as important as any of the actors, in my opinion, in the movie.
Oh yeah, especially in this type of movie. Yeah. But I've always kind of thought of it like they say with poetry, every word counts. Mm-hmm. And I've always kind of tried to think of movies in that way. That it's easy to just watch a movie and just assume that decisions were made randomly. Like mm-hmm. this room is just decorated this way, but that's not the case. Nope. They built the set. So why exactly did they put these things in the set, in that place? Why did they make this a certain color? And when you look at a movie like that, you usually can draw connections that you wouldn't have otherwise if you just sort of accepted it as, you know, a story, just a plot. But what do you think about the fact that neither of us picked a scene for our best moment?
Well,
what does that say about this movie?
Well, it says it's great. No, I think that, the emotion between characters is not the strength of this movie. And so it is a different kind of experience from a lot of the ones that we've praised highly recently on this podcast.
Yeah.
For sure. And, it's why, you know, I'll reveal now. I'm going to keep the movie and I really do love it.
I thought you would,
but I don't know 100% if it's kind of a borderline one, you know, because of that reason.
But also, you're a news guy. All the President's Men.
Absolutely. You know, that's one of your favorite movies. Absolutely. And I think that I like movies that try to take on these big ideas, like what you're talking about, the speech that you mentioned. Mm-hmm. So, you know, but I don't think that that's kind of one of the weaknesses of All the President's Men, too. I mean, which character in All the President's Men are you like heartbroken about something that happens to them? Yeah. You're not. It's really about the ideas. It's kind of quasi-documentary. But is there enough there to still say that's one of the best five of the year? A lot of critics thought so. I certainly think that it belongs in the conversation. But there, you know, I haven't seen very many movies from 05 yet. I think this is like, I'm only on like two or three.
So you like this better than Constantine?
I haven't watched it yet.
All right.
I'm excited to see that. Is that like better than Equilibrium or worse?
Oh, Equilibrium's so good. I think I'll take Equilibrium over Constantine.
I'm not going to watch Constantine then. I'm sorry. Thank you for saving me 2 hours of my life.
I'm a sucker for Equilibrium, though. You know that going in. Constantine's got Keanu, and he's at his most wooden, which I love. Mm. I love wooden Keanu.
You like David Strathairn woodenness and Keanu woodenness? Which one is better?
I prefer Keanu. Yeah, any day.
If one person can hold one expression for 2 hours, it's got to be Keanu is the best at that, right?
And really, if we're thinking about it, Christian Bale is super wooden in Equilibrium.
He is.
So a lot of connections abound here.
Both are great. A close runner-up, by the way, for my favorite moment for Farley was David Strathairn suffering through the puff piece on Liberace.
Oh, man.
It's hilarious.
He does play that really
well. It's so
well.
Funny. And like he's like, you know, the fake laughs, you know? It's so good.
Trying to act like he cares about his relationship status in any way.
Yeah. Okay, golden takes. What's your golden take, Mike?
All right. So you've brought up in past episodes that factual inaccuracies annoy you, especially when it comes to sort of historical dramas. My golden take is that filmmakers could also be a little too facts. Mm. I brought a clip. Let's just hear this clip.
Earlier, the senator asked, upon what meat does this our Caesar feed? Had he looked three lines earlier in Shakespeare's Caesar, he would have found this line, which is not altogether inappropriate. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves. No one familiar with the history of his country can deny that congressional committees are useful. It is necessary to investigate before legislating. But the line between investigating and persecuting is a very fine one, and the junior senator from Wisconsin has stepped over it repeatedly.
So that is not a scene from the movie, but you will notice it's actually the real Murrow. But you'll notice it is almost verbatim, if not 100% verbatim, to a speech that Strathairn, as Murrow, delivers in this movie. So
quoting Julius Caesar, Shakespeare.
Yeah, yeah. So the movie obviously is about observing history, you know, focusing on the facts. And that's noble, you know. I think even interesting, because there is plenty of drama in real life. And I think that, if you know, we don't need to accelerate real life, you know, exaggerate it in order for a story to be interesting. You know, just last episode, I was talking about how much I love Before Sunset, and there's nothing exaggerated about that movie at all. But but you know what I mean. But the same as we were mixed on Jamie Foxx's performance as Ray Charles, saying that it was kind of a great impersonation, but is it an emotional performance? Isn't this the same thing?
Is that your question or your golden take?
I think that there is a...
You have to separate them. It's very important that we stay on track here.
Yeah, okay. I'm sorry. I don't want to jump around. So, but there's a sense in biopics and historical dramas, I think, that we need to respect the past, you know, not tamper with it. And especially with movies that are socially important, McCarthyism, Red Scare, there's like a reverence in that. And there's a ton of reverence in this movie. You know, a lot of shots of characters watching Murrow as he speaks almost in awe, you know, very stoic, silent, just like letting the moment happen because they know they're standing up for something noble. And I just always feel like, I've mentioned this before, that sense of importance is preloaded into a movie like this before the movie even starts. So we kind of go into it wanting it to live up to that bar. And I can't always feel like it's earned it.
What was the question you asked me? Because I did want to answer it.
That isn't our criticism of Jamie Foxx's performance as Ray Charles as being a great interpretation, a great impersonation, I should say, but not necessarily an emotional performance. Is that really any problem? Different than this movie just being so loyal to the facts that, you know, we can see Ray Charles in the facts, but what do we get out of that on an emotional level?
I definitely can understand what you're saying. I guess the contest of ideas here was intellectually engaging, to the point where that drama that you look for succeeds to me. Let me talk a little bit about my golden take, because it kind of bounces off a little bit what you're saying.
Okay.
The dialogue in this movie is phenomenal. not just the words that they say, but some of the way that the conflict is set up through, you heard some of this
a lot of characters talking over one another.
They're not listening to each other. But each time someone is challenging you with a question, and it sounds like I got you there. And there's this kind of tension that's set up from that claim. And then instead of responding to that question, the challenged ignores the question and comes back with a similarly seemingly sort of condemning question that says, no, I'm right and you're wrong. And I think the tension that's created is so well done, so masterful. Mark Gilliland, our illustrious producer.
So illustrious.
I sent a clip that is, some of it's a repeat of the what we heard in the trailer.
Okay.
This is, I think, 45 seconds or so from that. It's a scene where George Clooney is sitting there at his desk with two generals, or colonels, two generals.
Two colonels, they make a
general. and he's like, he's sort of trying to stand up to them, and then they're standing up to him, and you're like,
where's the power here?
Should someone back down? Mm-hmm. You know, so if you could play that, Mark, we'll talk about it a second after.
Without his constitutional right. And you, who also have not seen the evidence, are claiming he's not a security risk. Wouldn't you guess that the people who have seen the contents of that envelope might have a better idea of what makes someone a danger to his country?
Who?
Or do you think
who
it should just be
people,
you
sir?
That decides?
Who are the people? Are they elected? Are they appointed? Do they have an axe to grind? Is it you, sir? Or you, Colonel Jenkins? Do you know the contents of that sealed envelope?
Mr. Friendly, we have been a friend and ally of both Mr. Murrow and CBS News for many years. The story you are going to run tomorrow is without merit. So before you take any steps that cannot be undone, I strongly urge you to reconsider your stand.
So the second general doesn't answer George Clooney at all.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is dramatic tension. That's not just being true to the facts there. I don't know. I mean, I doubt that they have like some transcript of what that, you know, what that conversation was like. That is dialogue writers who are turning, you know, some ideas of what that interaction might have been like into, in my opinion, high drama. This is sort of like, you know, what Aaron Sorkin does, I think, recreating these kind of things. So that's my golden take, is that technique in this dialogue elevates the movie into a different kind of, you know, stratosphere when it comes to, we're dramatizing history, but we're also adding this layer of art, and I think it works.
Yeah. Art, not only in the way that it looks, not only in that dialogue writing, but also Clooney does a lot. He leaves a lot of room for quiet and for silence in this movie, a lot of patience. And I think tonally, I find that interesting. I'm on board with it, but I just never found it moving in this. And kind of that's what I'm looking for. I sort of want some sort of emotional hook in movies. And since this doesn't have it, you know, there's always kind of that level where you can say, well, I admire this movie, but do I like it?
Right.
I don't know. And is that the same thing?
That's a good question. That's what we keep wrestling with, whether we keep a movie or not.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen this movie probably four times. I bought it back in the day, you know, and I don't know, I keep coming back to it. I think that the ideas of whether the news should be, you know, whether Ed Murrow should use his platform to, you know, he's taking a big risk and he's being very brave. So to me, like when you watch the scenes where he's like, I mean, all he's doing is looking at the camera and holding a cigarette and talking.
You know? I love the fact that they use smoke on the
I know,
news.
It seems so foreign now.
It's so ridiculous.
But when you look at, when I was going back and looking for some of the screenshots I wanted to capture, I actually watched some of the video without sound. And looking at the expressions on everyone's faces in the newsroom, that all the producers and everybody who's looking, they're like in awe of Ed Murrow. He's like a warrior to them in this world. And I could feel that kind of like admiration for him. Just like everybody has principles. I think that's why some of those dialogue moments work, is like, I'm not going to be bullied into just doing what you say because you say it, because I'm standing for something here. And everybody in the movie is doing that in some way. And I think that that's kind of inspiring to see that.
I think the inspiration element, though, is almost what I have a problem with, because I almost feel like a movie like this on some level is built to make us feel smart and socially responsible just by having watched it. And watching it can be a completely passive experience, but then we somehow feel like, okay, now we're also on the quote right side of history because Murrow was, and this movie, he's the hero. And so does that...
I don't see why watching the movie means that now we're passive. I mean, we're actively learning. We could have watched something else, and we're watching this now. And
Are we learning, though? Nothing is new here. We know this story. We know that McCarthyism is bad. We know that free speech is ultimately what took him down. So we're just kind of getting that reminder, but the reminder feels like a lesson. And because we can tell ourselves this is informative and not just entertainment, then I'm doing something good right now rather than just looking at the idiot box.
I think this movie, first of all, the frame story, I think is trying to disrupt what you're saying. I think the speech at the beginning and the end, he's not happy in the speech. He's supposed to be like the celebratory thing. And instead he's making everybody uncomfortable by saying, you're not using TV like you should to be a weapon, a tool for righteousness and to do good in the world. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's supposed to leave you at the end kind of feeling a little bit unsettled. And I think that's why it's not just like a feel good look at history. And
no, I don't think that it's a feel good. I think that by being on his side, because he's the hero, when he delivers that speech about, TVs can be, if we don't use TVs for a tool to make us live more civil lives, then all this instrument is in society is a box full of wires and light.
Yeah.
And we're on his side when he says that. So it's almost like we feel like we're part of the revolution, you know, turning TV into an educational tool. But what are we doing?
So then after the movie's over, we should do something about it. I don't think
anybody does. I think that's my issue here.
Well, I think that's why Ed Murrow gave that speech in 1950 or 60 something, because he felt that it wasn't happening then either. But I do think that, I think that George Clooney,
that's why he made this movie.
He's trying to repeat Ed Murrow's statement because it was needed again. It's a reminder 50 years later, 40 years later, that we still need to try to use, you know, our platform to do something worthwhile. So,
I don't want to belabor the point. To me, it kind of feels like an unearned sense of personal satisfaction. But now, since I've had the last word, we can move on.
So, questions. Let's talk about Don Hollenbeck. Don Hollenbeck is the, it's Ed Murrow's kind of like, he's a news anchor who comes on TV right after Ed Murrow. Mm-hmm. And he really looks up to Ed Murrow. He's very insecure. He's also gone through a, you know, divorce, and you can tell early on that he's really fragile emotionally and he's looking for affirmation. He doesn't get it. And he dies by suicide in the movie. So my question is, what is the dramatic story reason why that is included? Why that storyline is part of the movie? And did you think that that was a good thing, or kind of distracted from? Was it like a strong writing move or a cheap writing move? Or what were your thoughts on it?
I thought that it was sort of an attempt to just give this movie some sort of emotional heart, because he plays that sort of hard on your sleeve, you know, raw nerve ending thing without any artifice at all. I mean, in every scene, it looks like he's just trying to hold it together.
The acting is great. And I think he plays the role well. I forget what the actor's name is.
He's the dad from Twin Peaks. What more do you need to know?
Very good.
I don't really know that it worked for me, because I don't know if it's because I've seen this movie before, years and years ago, or in his performance, but I just got the sense that this guy's not going to make it, because they're sort of setting it up every scene where he just kind of wants to be liked by this group. He wants Murrow to respect him. He wants to...
wants O'Brien to like him,
the critic. He's so torn up that the critic doesn't like him. And he has that desperation to him. So it kind of felt like, all right, now we're just waiting for the other shoe to drop, because this has been so well set up. Does it work for me? I didn't hate it. It wasn't a detraction, but I'm not sure that it added a whole lot.
It occurred to me watching it this time that it felt a little bit like, it felt a little bit forced to include that storyline in. It wasn't 100% accurate as far as like the timing of it. I mean, he actually died by suicide on June 22nd, which was like, and Murrow did his documentary on March 9th. So like it was months apart when it actually happened, and the movie kind of puts it together. And George Clooney said on the DVD, apparently, that it was, you know, they combined the two for dramatic reasons. Again, how much of that do you want? Do you care about? I don't know. But I thought that it was fine. But I kind of wondered, I think, you know, this is a what might have been, perhaps, but just out of my own, you know, imagination, not from really it might have been. But I kind of wonder, if you're going to give a little bit of license, why not make Murrow's personal life and personal struggle, why not give that some screen time instead of, you know, the other guy? Maybe it's because, well, they saw that, well, this guy died by suicide right after. So that's kind of a good opportunity to tell that full story and what it impacted.
And it raises the stakes of what Murrow is doing. Because now it seems like this is not just an ethical issue. It's not just about his reputation or his job. Lives are at stake.
It shows how much emotional consequence there could be for being as brave as Murrow is being. And withstanding the, you know, slings and arrows of these critics. But again, they didn't raise the personal stakes for Murrow himself. They didn't raise the stakes for Fred Friendly, George Clooney's character. And I wonder if the movie would have been better if it did that for those people, because they're the main characters that you're supposed to be, you know, focused on.
Yeah.
Anyway, also, this is a what might have been that I'm just making up, but I would like to see Charlie Kaufman make this movie.
Me too. I would too. All right, my question, Brian. Mm-hmm. Joe Williams, the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. That name, that newspaper Post name, it's a little bit too long, I think. Let's trim it down. He called Good Night and Good Luck, quote, one of the most patriotic movies ever made. React.
One of the most patriotic movies ever made.
Or is it one of the most self-serious movies ever made?
I think that it is very patriotic. I do.
Does that make it better?
I think that patriotism is a emotion that is worth fostering in people. You know, I hope that my children are patriotic. Mm-hmm. It kind of wounds me a little bit when I hear my like teenage son say that, oh, we're just America, you know. I don't know.
You need
I don't
some
like
of that,
that
though. You need some of that. Well, because you got to be able to look outward and see your faults.
You should watch this and you should watch Team America.
Always. I will always stump for people watching Team America.
That should be paired with every movie that we do, right?
Yes, every double feature is better with
Team America. I agree with Roger Ebert that Team America's, where it falls flat is the nihilism. That's the word he used. It's like, this is what Parker and Stone are all about. We're going to insult and offend every possible person and, you know, point of view to the point where you can't help but laugh at it. And some of that is healthy. We got to laugh at ourselves.
Yeah.
But it's sort of like, you know, I use this analogy with Aronofsky's movie from
Requiem.
Yes. Requiem for a Dream. You have this amazing, incredible high powered laser. And what are you pointing it at exactly? You know, what are you, could it be to a higher purpose, like instilling patriotism in us?
I think it is in a way, maybe not patriotism so much, but I mean, Team America I see as more of an indictment on certainty, on people who are so sure that they understand things, that they know the answers, that they understand what right and wrong is, and that they're right, that that almost turns into a destructive force rather than, you know, you like the benevolent destructive thing. Mm-hmm. It goes from sort of good intentions to destruction because you leave no room for actually educating yourself because you're like, we are America. Of course we're right. Yeah. And if you go through that movie, everybody who gets made fun of is basically
if you
falls into that group, whether George you're Clooney a terrorist or George Clooney, you know, the actors.
There is a danger to saying the premise is I am right. Mm-hmm. America is right. Yes. And now whatever happens, I'm going to twist it to the point where America still looks like it's mm-hmm. always on the right and I'm always on the right. And
if we're right, then by definition, anything that we're doing is right.
That's dangerous and that's not good. But that's not patriotism to me. And I don't think that's what the movie is doing. I think that standing up for certain ideals, mm-hmm. and that's what I think it's doing. Like being brave, you know, like the speech you just read about what Murrow said. I think that you can confidently say that is always something to stand up for, and I hope that's what patriotism essentially is really about.
So where is the line between pretension and patriotism in a movie? Because if you're really self-serious, that's okay. You know, a little pretension in a movie is fine because it does show that they have higher goals here than to just entertain, and that's good. But kind of keeping in mind that reservation that I have about importance being imbued maybe unfairly or unearned, by having that those higher aspirations, does that necessarily mean that a movie is worth more than one that is just seeking to entertain?
I don't think so. I think that I'm picturing, like, you know, Harrison. I can't picture exactly which movie I'm thinking of, but a movie where, like, you know, you'd see the White House and there's a setting sun and you see an eagle fly over or something and like there's swelling string music and it's like it's trying to make you feel, you know, good about this without earning it. I think this earns it. I don't think this is sentimentalizing it. And that's maybe why I think it does succeed. Although there are some people who thought that it was a little bit like making Ed Murrow into a little more of a hero than he really deserved to be, because it was not like he was the only person who ever criticized Joe McCarthy.
Yeah. And maybe that's why they stayed out of his personal life, because then you're able to just focus on his work and not get distracted by that other stuff. Did you ever think about cancel culture, social media,
with
fake news
with this movie?
In terms of this movie?
I think it does, because all these people, like when they're, you know, George Clooney's character is saying, like, has anybody in here ever had anything wrong or any communist ties in their past? If you ever subscribed to something or went to a party, then you are forever, you know, being banned or being ostracized. And Joe McCarthy was essentially using that as a, you know, as a weapon. Interesting that some people criticized the movie early on in the screenings because they thought that the actor who played Joe McCarthy was so bad.
It's actually the real Joe McCarthy, the real footage.
Yeah.
Taking those long breaks and the deep, heavy breathing in his speeches. That guy was the worst.
Who did his hair?
That little curl in the front.
So what might have been?
Yeah.
I just have one of these for good night, comma, and good luck, period.
Okay.
Did you notice that there's a period at the end of good night and good luck movie, on the poster? Like that's, the period is part of the title.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I admire that when people use punctuation
in a movie title
like that. Yeah. I only have one. I was just looking through some of the actors' like careers, and Jeff Daniels was considered for the role of Joey Gladstone on Full House. Could you imagine Jeff Daniels as a regular on Full House?
Yeah, I can.
Do you think it would have maybe ruined
his career? I don't know. I don't think so, because it seems like he's really been laser focused on if I do something wacky and funny, then I need to do something serious to sort of balance it out and maintain, you know, the knowledge in culture that I can do both. And I think that that's worked for him.
The first movie that I ever saw Jeff Daniels was Dumb and Dumber.
Of course.
So I always thought for years and years that was kind of like he came up as like a comedian, like Jim Carrey or something, but he actually did mostly serious stuff for most of his career. That's kind of one of the outliers. Okay. So here's some trivia for you. George Clooney said that shortly after he met Grant Heslov in 1982, they've been together for a long time as a, you know, writing pair and movie makers together, that Heslov loaned George Clooney $200 to get his first pair of headshots.
Good investment.
And he was, you know, he's forever poor, you know, having to get only a dollar for writing Good Night and Good Luck, period. So let's see. So George Clooney majored in journalism in college. So that kind of helps to inform some mm-hmm. of his sentiment toward this movie. And his father, Nick Clooney, was a television journalist for many years. And he ran for Congress in 2004, just before this movie was made. Kind of a cool tidbit about how the movie was made. So this was all on a sound set. But yet the camera follows actors into an elevator and they go to another floor. So what really happened is they go in the elevator and the elevator set mm-hmm. turns instead of going up, and it opens up into a, you know, another part of the same floor.
Ah, that's cool.
So, that probably accounted for half of the budget.
Yeah, that's $3.5 million right there.
So David Strathairn, he did a lot of, theater work over his career. When he was first starting out, he decided to be a clown with Ringling Brothers, and he went around for 6 months with the circus. It's fantastic.
I like it. It's good. It's good.
When he got to, came back to New York, he spent several years hitchhiking, working at local theaters. Let's see. George Clooney, while they're making the movie, this is a good one. You would love this.
I better.
He gave his cast copies of newspapers from that day in 1953 as they were making the movie. Because you got to get in character. You got to read up on this.
Yeah. It's kind of
you love that.
Yeah,
you love
I
that
do
stuff.
Like that more than taking cold showers if you're
Cate Blanchett.
Yeah, Cate Blanchett. Because at least this way, that gives them a little bit more of an idea of how these guys talked, you know, how these news writers spoke and wrote.
Would you rather mm-hmm. take a cold shower or read a newspaper from 1953 of this day?
Do I have to read it front to back, every word?
In the shower.
Because now I'm trying to think which one would take longer, and I would take the shorter one.
A 2-minute cold shower rather than reading a whole newspaper. From
1953. I think so.
All right, the big reveal, Mike.
I love the look. I admire
that's
it.
That's why you're keeping the movie.
But movies like this just don't thrill me. You know, I tend to prefer a movie that's more personal than political. Mm-hmm. And then when you throw on the fact that this is celebrating an historical figure, it's got the biopic thing I complain about all the time, promotes free speech and freedom of thought, which are not exactly hard
you don't like
sells.
Those? You don't like those?
They're kind of easy thing. I mean, who's going to say that Murrow was wrong here? I think it's an easy bandwagon to jump on.
Joe McCarthy did, though. I mean, it wasn't exactly it was a risky move.
But this was 2005
it was
that
risky
this was
move.
Made. Yeah. So it's easy to villainize McCarthy, and we should. I'm not sticking up for Joe McCarthy here. but I don't think that we should confuse Murrow's bravery and risk with creative bravery and risk on screen.
In movie making.
Yes. Yeah. We project the importance of an historical event onto the screen, and I just don't buy it. The most patriotic movie ever made. It's a good movie. I'm glad I saw it, but it won't be making my top five.
What's the most patriotic movie that you've seen?
That's a really good question.
Braveheart?
Isn't that Scotland?
Well, it's still patriotic.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, I just am patriotic to America, Brian. I don't recognize
Is
other
Team
countries.
Team America the most patriotic movie you've
Yes,
seen?
I'll go with Team America.
An American Tale, maybe?
Maybe.
Five Hole Goes West?
So you're going to keep this one.
I'm going to keep it. I'm going to say probably, because again, this is early on in the 2005s.
You haven't seen Constantine yet.
I haven't seen Constantine. Mm-hmm. The first movie that I watched from 2005 was The New World, directed by Terrence Malick. Mm-hmm. And I was shocked at how much I enjoyed that movie. And so when I see that and then I see this, I'm kind of like, well, I need to wait a little bit. But if I were to just looking at the movies that I know that I've already seen in 05, then I think this has a good chance of making my top five. I really did like it, and I'm not going to be swayed by your criticisms of it.
Fair enough.
Joe McCarthy is listening to you right now, by the way.
God.
I love the cinematography too. The shot by shot. It's so good. I do really like the interplay of the music with the movie. When the sound and the music are intertwined with the setting itself, rather than just like a pure straight up soundtrack, I always like that. You know, that's creative to kind of see, or like you're seeing like people drive in a car and then you think that it's just a soundtrack and then they stop the car and the music stopped and you realize, I mean, theoretically, that it was just part of this.
It's diegetic.
I like that
word. Is that word? If it's in scene, yeah.
Oh, very good. I must look more of that up. The dialogue is also great, as I mentioned before. So I'm going to say I'll keep this movie. In the next movie, we'll talk about a movie that I have not seen, but is a classic from the year, Brokeback Mountain. Ang Lee's Best Picture nominee about cowboy love.
We want to hear from you.
Is that correct?
Like, yeah.
If you had to describe it in two words, is cowboy love?
I would define it as human love.
Human
maybe
love.
Not cowboy love, but
they're cowboys, aren't they?
I suppose. So, let us know. Are movies that deal with important historical events, do they deserve to be thought of as important?
Yeah, they do.
I think we need.
Were you asking me?
We need to hear from the people on this, Brian. You can find us at bestpicturethis.com on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or wherever else you listen. We're also on Facebook and Twitter at Best Picture This. And for 15 years of golden takes, head over to Letterboxd, where you'll find me, Mike Cavalieri.
To support the show and help select a movie for a bonus episode, visit patreon.com/bestpicturethis.
Thanks to WNZF and the illustrious Mark Gilliland for producing, and please remember to rate, review, and subscribe to the show.
Until next time, put out that cigarette, don't smoke, and good night and good luck. Period.